Lord, let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the Bible study. Thank you for your love that has drawn us into the kingdom to become members of the family of God. We're asking, Lord, that your love will be implanted in every heart, even as you've always done for all your children, in Jesus' name. And we're asking, Lord, that the love will not just be hidden there, it will come out, it will be expressed in all we do, in all we think, and in all our relationships, in Jesus' name. We're asking, Lord, that tonight you write your word upon the table of every heart, and that word will live and be strong every time in everything we do, all areas of our lives, in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Another good amen. Tonight we are coming to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Already we have studied verses 1, 2, and 3. And those verses tell us and show us plainly and clearly the importance of love and the indispensability of love and the very essence of love. That as we are following the Lord, there are gifts and there are graces. There is character, there is charisma, and that the charisma, the gifts, the operations, the skill, the ability we possess, all will mean nothing to God, all will mean nothing to us in eternity if there is no charity. Now that word charity there is the King James Version of translating not love. It actually means love. The love of God in the heart of man. You are born again and you are drawn by the love of God. And as you are born again, you are living the life of a believer, of a born again child of God. The love of God is spread abroad in our heart by the Holy Spirit. And then the Lord expects that everything we do towards him, everything we do towards our neighbor, everything we do in any place and everywhere will be out of that love. And it is not erotic love, it is not the worldly love, it's not the kind of love we read about in literature. It is the love of God, the love of God coming from heaven, poured out into the heart, and then stretching forth the hand of love, the hand of kindness, and the hand of mercy unto everyone around us. And now we're learning about those properties of love today. We're learning about the characteristics of the love of God today. And so we come to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. We're reading from verse 4 all through to verse 7. Please open your Bible. It says, charity suffereth long and is kind. Charity envieth not, charity vaunteth not itself, and is not puffed up. Then it tells us in verse 5, it says that charity does not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil. And then in verse 6, it tells us the charity rejoices not in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. And then verse 7 now says that charity beareth all things, that charity believeth all things, that charity hopeth all things, that charity endureth all things. Tonight the topic is living with deep-rooted love from sanctified hearts. All the issues of life, all the things we do in life, they come from the heart. And when the heart is saved, and when the heart is made free, and the heart is sanctified, and the very nature of God, God is love. And the nature of God is love. And the very nature of God is implanted in that heart, in the sanctified heart, there will be deep-rooted love. And we'll be living, we'll be acting, we'll be behaving, and doing all things by that deep-rooted love from our sanctified hearts. Today we are considering the subject under three perspectives. Look at number one, gracious restraints of divine love in the heart. When the love of God comes to the heart, it restrains us. There are things that, you know, the human mind and the human life will be driven to do. It's like there are people, even that's the nature of man, propelled to do something, and then love in the heart will examine that thing you want to do, that thing you want to say, that way you want to act, and then the love of God will restrain you if it is not something very good, if it is not something that will bring glory to God, that will bring joy to your neighbor. Number one, glorious restraints of divine love in the heart. Number two, graceful response of demonstrable love from the heart. The love we're talking about is something demonstrated. It's something that is acted out. It's something that comes out as you're relating with your neighbor. And you're relating with your brother, with your sister, with the husband, with the wife, with your children, with your parents, with your neighbors, with your co-workers. That love makes you to respond to them, and the people can tell that's a demonstration of love. That's not a demonstration of anger. That's not a demonstration of hatred. That's not a demonstration of malice. That is a demonstration of love. People can tell from what source our actions are coming from, whether it is coming out of love or out of hatred or animosity. But when the love of God is implanted in our heart and it is deep-rooted in our heart, it will make us to have graceful response of demonstrable love coming from the heart to everyone around us. Number three now is gainful relationship. You see, the relationship we have can be gainful, can be profitable, can be uplifting, can be encouraging, that anyone you meet, anyone you interact with, your relationship with them makes them to move forward. And then it says there's a gainful relationship. Anytime I relate with that man, anytime I relate with that woman, gainful relationship through decisive love is the love from the heart and the love from the will that you decide. It's your decision. It is not what happens to you that makes you do what you do. It is your own decision. I will act in love. I will speak in love. I will do everything and relate with people in love. That's the mind of a real child of God. Gainful relationship through decisive love in all honesty. There's no dishonesty. There's no pretense. There's no hiding hatred in your heart and then smiling superficially. You are honest about it because it is the love of God that is deep-rooted in the heart and planted in the heart. Let's come to number one now. Number one is the gracious restraint of divine love in the heart. We're coming back to 1 Corinthians chapter 4, chapter 13, and we're reading from verse 4. It says, charity, that is divine love, agape love, the love of God in the heart, charity suffereth long and is kind. Charity envieth not, and charity vaunteth not itself, and is not puffed up. And then in verse 5, it tells us it does not behave itself unseemly. When people behave unseemly, that means the behavior is not acceptable. Their mind, their heart did not agree together. And then it comes out as if, what is wrong? Brother so-and-so is not normally like that. What went wrong today? Sister so-and-so is not normally like that. What went wrong today? That means the people realize that we have behaved unseemly. But you know, the love of God ever flowing, the love of God ever constant, the love of God ever visible, will not behave itself unseemly. Seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil. It's when somebody is provoked, he will think evil. That is, something has happened to him and he's angry. it has happened to him, and his mind, his spirit is provoked. That provocation will lead him to wanting to do evil or speak evil or act in an evil way unto the other person. They are all linked together. But when he is not provoked, then he will not think of doing evil to anyone. Let's look at three things here. Number one, long-suffering without pride or puffing up. Long-suffering without pride or puffing up. Number two, lowliness without pursuit, the pursuit of preeminence. A person who has love, he wants the other person to succeed. He's not pursuing preeminence over everybody in everything so that he alone will be identified as doing something good and all the other people are either worthless or they're useless. But lowliness characterizes charity, and it's lowliness without the pursuit of preeminence. Number three, loveliness without provocation or perverseness. Look at number one there. Number one there is long-suffering without pride or puffing up. Already we have read in verse 4, it says, charity suffereth long and is kind. When suffering is long, when persecution is long, when things happen to you and they happen in quick succession, it happened the other time, it happened the other time, it happened the other time, it registers in your mind that this has been going on for a long time. And then the devil will come in, won't you do something so that you can stop this? You say no. The love of God deep-rooted in the heart suffereth long and remains kind. There are people, when they suffer, they cannot be kind at that same time. When they are persecuted, they cannot be kind at that same time. And when something robs them the opposite way, they cannot be kind at that time. But you know, when the love of God is in our heart, I pray the love of God will be in our hearts. In your heart, in my heart, in every one of us, in Jesus' name, then we suffer longer and yet we remain kind. And then there's no pride. That charity envieth not, that charity vaunteth not itself, and that charity is not puffed up. Why? Because we have the fruit of the Spirit. If we are born again, the Spirit of God comes into our lives, comes into our hearts, and that Spirit of God will produce His fruit by His presence. Look at Galatians chapter 5, reading from verse 22. Galatians chapter 5, verse 22. It says, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love." The fruit of the Spirit is love. There are people that tell us they have the Spirit of God, they are filled with the Spirit of God, they are baptized in the Spirit of God, and it looks like the spirit of hatred, and the spirit of anger, and the spirit of violence. No, that's not the Holy Ghost. When you have the Holy Ghost, and the Holy Ghost testifies and bear witness in your heart that you're a real child of God, the fruit of the Spirit is love and joy. There are people that say they're born again, they're even baptized in the Holy Ghost, and they're speaking in tongues, but you look at their lives, there's no joy. There's no happiness. They're always sorrowful, always morose. It's like the whole world is on them. The Spirit of God will bear the fruit of love and the fruit of joy and the fruit of peace. And look at this now, and long suffering. That's the manifestation of the presence of the Spirit in our hearts. It's the manifestation of the prominence of the Spirit in our heart. When the Spirit of God is in us and is prominent, there'll be love, there'll be joy, there'll be peace, there'll be long suffering, gentleness, goodness, and faith. And then in verse 23, we're told meekness, and that means you'll be lowly, you'll be humble. Temperance, that's self-control. You'll be able to deny yourself. Against such, there is no law. In verse 24, it tells us, and they that are Christ have crucified the flesh. They belong to Christ, and therefore deliberately they crucify the flesh. And it says, with the affections and the laws. And then in verse 25, it says, if we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Verse 26 tells us, let us not be desirous of vain glory. That is, when your heart is full of love, you'll not be desirous of pride, vainglory, wanting to shine above the other person, always making carnal comparison between yourself and another person, always wanting to rise higher, go higher than the other person, because you have vainglory. When the love of God is there, and the love of God is not just an idea in the head, it's not just an idea, an opinion, a verse of scripture I have read about. That love of God, when it is deep in the heart, out of the experience of salvation, out of the experience of relationship with the Lord, it says there'll be no vainglory. You don't even desire to have any vainglory against anyone, provoking one another. When you are saved, it is not your intention to provoke anybody. And when Christ lives in your heart, abides in your heart, it's not in your intention to provoke anyone. It says provoking one another, envy one another. I pray that this deep-rooted love of God will be present and prominent, preeminent in every one of our lives, in Jesus' name. In Colossians chapter 3, we're looking at verse 12. Colossians chapter 3, verse 12, put on, therefore, as the elect of God. When God has chosen you, you have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you so that you will produce fruit, you will bear fruit, and that your fruit will remain. When you are chosen like that, you become the elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercies, that's what you put on, kindness, that's what you put on, even when you are suffering, even when you are persecuted, even when you are misunderstood, even when you are criticized, even when something painful is happening, you will have kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, and long suffering. And then in verse 13, it tells us, forbearing one another and forgiving one another, if any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. And then in verse 14, it says, above all these things, put on charity. Wear it like you wear your clothes. Make sure that that charity and that love of God is from the heart. It influences your tongue, influences your language, influences your action, influences your interaction, influences literally everything you are and everything you do. And people can see that as they're seeing the clothes that you put on. Above all these things, put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness. And then in verse 15 it says, and let the peace of God rule in your heart. What that means is that you're not trying to suppress the anger. You're not trying to suppress the animosity. You're not gritting your teeth and say, I will not talk, I will not talk. It's not like that. The love of God will ease everything up. And the love of God will bring peace in your heart. And you say, the peace of God will rule in your heart, to the which also ye are called in one body. And be ye thankful. We're looking at Philippians chapter 2, reading from verse 3. Philippians chapter 2, verse 3. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory. Why? Because whatever we gain, if we strive, if we're violent, if we're vainglorious, whatever we gain is nothing. there's no profit there. And it doesn't make for spiritual progress or intimacy with the Lord. So it says, if you are following Christ, if you have the love of God, and if it's flowing in your heart, if it is being expressed every time, if you put on charity, and people can see that charity and love, like the clothes you are putting on, let nothing, small or great, let nothing in the day or in the night, let nothing with people you are familiar with and people you are not familiar with, let nothing with friends or foes, let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. And then in verse 4, it says, look not every man on his own things. What am I going to gain? What am I going to get? What's my profit there? What is coming to me out of this? Let nothing like that happen. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. What does that sum? It is sum total of that. What does it come to? That's in verse 5. It says, let this mind be you, which was also in Christ Jesus. He acted in love, he spoke in love, he even sacrificed his life because of the love he has for the whole of humanity. Put on Christ then, and let the virtues of Christ clean off and wipe off all the vices of the world and of hatred. Let the mind of Christ be in you, and then the love of God will flow through you every time. We're coming to number 2 here. Number 2 is lowliness without the pursuit of preeminence. Lowliness without the pursuit of preeminence. Look at 3 John chapter 1. Only one chapter there. 3 John chapter 1 verse 9. It's talking about a man in a particular church that John the Beloved wrote about. It says, I wrote unto the church, but Diotrephes, who loveth to have preeminence among them, receiveth us not. You see, he didn't have the love of God. He only had the love for preeminence, the love for being above everyone, above every minister, above every pastor, whether it's the resident pastor or it's a visiting pastor. He puts himself there as the Lord of all. He had preeminence. When that happens, that somebody is always wanting to have preeminence, is always wanting to have the final say, is always wanting to override every other person and all the other people, they matter not. If somebody is like that, the love of God is not in his heart. He may have gifts, speak in tongues, he may have gifts, have mountain moving faith, he may have gifts, he may understand all mysteries, he may have gifts, and he may even give himself to be burnt for religion. But if the pursuit of preeminence is there, he doesn't have the love of God in him. And I hope a person like that does not die in that condition. A person who is seeking preeminence is competing with God. It's God, it's Christ that should have the preeminence. But he wants to have the preeminence. He wants Jesus down. He wants himself, herself up. I hope nobody dies like that in our congregation, because it will mean the other side forever. In Jeremiah chapter 45, reading from verse 5. Jeremiah chapter 45, reading from verse 5. Seekest thou great things for thyself? Seekest thou great things for thyself? Seek them not, for behold, I will bring evil upon all flesh, says the Lord. But thy life will I give unto thee for a prey in all places whither thou goest. You notice the last part of that sentence, in all places which that you go, anywhere you go, anywhere you find yourself, do you seek great things for yourself? seek them not. The Lord is looking for the people that have the divine love of God in their hearts, and they're not always projecting themselves, always defending themselves, always pumping up themselves, and always wanting to have preeminence everywhere. If we're like Christ, look at the nature of Christ and look at the demonstration of the life of Christ in John chapter 7, reading from verse 18. John chapter 7, verse 18. He that speaketh of himself seeketh his own glory. If there are people that they are discussing, and this person must always come to the area of who I am, and what I have, and what I possess, and how great I am, how I went there, solved that problem, went there, solved that problem. He that speaketh of himself seeketh his own glory. But he that seeketh his glory, that sent him, the same is true. This is a real true child of God, a person who is seeking the glory of the one who has sent him, like Jesus did. And Jesus only uplifted the Father and sought the glory of the Father. In that way we know he is the true one, and there's no unrighteousness in him. In John chapter 8, reading from verse 50, it says, I seek not my own glory. That's our Lord. I seek not my own glory. That's the one that sacrificed everything. I seek not my own glory. That's the King of kings and the Lord of lords. I seek not my own glory. That's the Savior of the whole of humanity. I seek not my own glory. There is one that seeketh and judgeth. Let's look at number three here. Number three is a loveliness without provocation or perverseness. A loveliness without provocation or perverseness. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 5. Does not behave itself unseemly. Seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked. Is not easily provoked. That is, he has loveliness. Loveliness in character. Loveliness in language. Loveliness in relationship. Loveliness in conduct. Loveliness every time he smiles. I know some, they say that some Christians, they don't ever smile. The holiness they understand is a gloomy holiness. The holiness they understand is a holiness that appears is angry with everybody. But you know, when we have holiness, we have the love of God in our heart, and we'll not be wearing sad faces all the time and gloomy faces all the time, as if the whole world is offending us, and then the world is an offense. And he is not easy provoked. There are people who are provoked if, you know, their little children cry in the house. There are people who are provoked if, you know, something happens out of the ordinary, what they are not expecting, and they flare up, and they get angry. And yet they say, but you know, don't judge me by my action. You know, I flare up like that because I don't want to pretend, and I'm just myself everywhere. And I want to assure you I'm saved. I want to assure you I'm sanctified. That's talk of mouth. That's not a genuine experience. It says when we're sanctified, and when the love of God is there in our heart, it's not easily provoked, and it thinketh no evil. You cannot do evil except you think evil. You cannot do evil except you plan evil. You cannot do evil except you plot evil. But you know, when we're children of God, it tells us that heaven is so precious to us and Christ is so precious to us that we do not think evil. It's the people that think evil that do perverse things. But here we have loveliness without provocation or perverseness. We're looking at James chapter 1, reading from verse 19. James chapter 1, verse 19. Wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, and they're slow to wrath, slow to get angry. And you know something has happened. You don't know why that thing happened. You don't know the source of that thing. You don't know whether the thing is accidental. And you don't know whether it is planned or not planned. And something has happened. Immediately you react. And immediately you get angry. It says, why don't you slow down and think about it, and excuse whatever it is that may be happening, to be a beloved brother, a beloved sister, a beloved husband, a beloved wife, a beloved member of the church, a beloved minister. Let everyone, husband or wife, let everyone, parent or child, let everyone, member or minister, be slow to speak and slow to wrath. Look at verse 20 there. It says in verse 20, for the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. If your aim is to keep the righteousness of God, wrath, anger, strife, violence, provocation will not produce righteousness. If your goal is to get to heaven and accept your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, ye shall in no wise enter into the kingdom of God. If you truly believe that Christ can come at any time, and you are living your life in the grace of God, in the mercy of God, and you know it takes the righteousness of faith and the righteousness that is the fruit of the love of God to help you on the final day to see the Lord face to face and to see the Lord in glory. If that righteousness is your pursuit, the wrath of man, the anger of man, the hatred of man, the strife of man, and the vainglory of man worketh not the righteousness of God. That's why it says in verse 21, wherefore lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word which is able to save your souls. And then in verse 22 it says, but be ye doers of the word. All that we're learning, I pray the grace to be a doer of the word. The Lord will grant to everyone in Jesus' name. But be ye doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. We're told in Mark chapter 7, reading from verse 21. Mark chapter 7, verse 21. For from within, out of the heart of men, proceed evil thoughts. It's not from outside. It's not what other people say. It's not what other people do. From the heart of the man proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders, verse 22. And then he goes on to say all the other things, thefts and covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lasciviousness, and evil eye, blasphemy, pride. It comes from the heart. If somebody is humble, it comes from the heart. If somebody is pompous and proud, pugnacious, is violent, fighting, it comes from the heart. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. And then he talks of foolishness. All those things come from the heart. What do they do? When provocation comes from the heart, oozes out or comes out, and then people can tell he's provoked, she's provoked, or people can tell he's proud, and the pride comes out either with bragging or boasting or threatening. What does that do? Look at verse 23. All these evil things, pride is an evil thing. Blasphemy is an evil sin. Provocation, anger, is an evil sin. And all these evil things come from within and defile the man. That's why the man, the woman who is having that pride and having that perversion and having that provocation cannot say, I am sanctified, I am holy, and I have Christ living in me, because he's defiled. Pride defiles. Puffing up defiles, and provocation defiles, and seeking preeminence defiles, and perverseness also defiles. All these evil things come from within and defile the man. We're told in 1 Peter chapter 3, reading from verse 8, 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 8, finally, be ye all of one mind, having compassion one of another, love as brethren, be pitiful, be courteous. Then in verse 9, not rendering evil for evil, or railing for railing, but contrariwise blessing, knowing that ye are thereunto called, that ye should inherit a blessing. We inherit blessing, you know, when we allow the love of God to prevail. What you lose because of what people do against you is nothing in comparison with the benefits you have and the blessings you have and the outpouring of the goodness of God you have when you allow the love of God to rule in your heart. It says we're called to blessing so that as we allow the love of God to prevail in everything we do, everywhere we go, then we'll be inheriting the blessings of the Lord. Look at verse 10. In verse 10, for he that will love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil and his lips that they speak no guile. It tells us in verse 11, it says, let him eschew evil, let him shun evil, let him detest evil, let him forsake evil and do good. Let him seek peace and ensue it. In verse 12, it says, for the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous, and his ears are open unto their prayers. But the face of the Lord is against them that do evil. Let's come to point number two now. Point number two, graceful response of demonstrable love from the heart. We're looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 13, and we're reading from verse 6. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, we're reading from verse 6. Rejoiceth not in iniquity. Remember, he's talking about charity. He's talking about the love of God in man. He's talking about divine love. He's talking about agape love. And he said that charity, that divine love, that agape love, that love of God in man, rejoices not in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. And you see what charity does. Three things here. Number one, courageously recovering transgressors from trespasses. When he sees a transgressor and he sees somebody in a trespass, he doesn't get angry. Anger will not recover people. Anger will not restore people. Anger will not reform people. Anger will just fight back, will make them to fight back. But you are courageously, by love, recovering transgressors from trespasses. Number two, constantly rejoicing in truth and truthfulness. It's rejoicing in the truth, and it's rejoicing in being truthful. Number three, confidently revealing the triumph of truth. He knows that truth will triumph. He knows error will not triumph. Falsehood will not triumph. Evil will not triumph. And because he knows that, the truth will triumph, is confidently revealing every time the triumph of the truth. We're looking at number one, courageously recovering transgressors from trespasses. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 2. We're reading from verse 25. In meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves. Not in anger, You cannot restore anyone or recover anyone with anger or with hatred or with vainglory or with fighting back or with show of force and show of power. In meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves, if God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth. Look at verse 26. It says, and that they might recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will. That's what the Lord expects. Suppose if people are going to repent, we show love to them. If people are going to recover themselves and they're going to recognize that that is evil, I should not go that way. It is out of love, the love of Christ in our heart, bringing the love of the believer, the soul winner, that will invite them and recover them. And it's only then they will turn and they will repent. Look at Acts chapter 8, verse 22. Acts chapter 8, reading from verse 22. Repent therefore of this thy wickedness, and pray God, if peradventure the thought of thine heart may be forgiven thee. You see, when you say that in love, and you say that with good intention, that they can be forgiven, they're not forever lost, and the Lord can still recover them. He gives them encouragement. Look at verse 23. It says, for I perceive, I can see, I can tell, thou art in the gall of bitterness. Now, bitterness will not correct bitterness. Bitterness will not reform bitterness. If Simon the sorcerer, who claimed to have been born again, is asking, forgive me this gift and then I'll give you money, there's bitterness in him. It's in the God of bitterness. If Simon Peter the apostle will react in bitterness, who do you think we are? Do you think we're serving money, the God of money? Do you think we're looking for your money? Who brought you here and who brought you into the gospel? Now, my brother, bitterness will not reform bitterness, and bitterness will not correct bitterness. If he is bitter, you must be sweet, and you must be nice, and you must speak in a way that will make him to see his error and make him to see his evil. Never try to conquer hatred with hatred. Never try to conquer malice with malice. Never try to conquer bitterness with bitterness. There's bitterness in the world, we know that. But let the love of God flow through you every time, whatever may be happening. For I perceive that thou art in the gall of bitterness and in the bunch of iniquity. Let's look at Ezekiel chapter 18. I'm reading from verse 30, Ezekiel 18, verse 30. Therefore, I will judge you, house of Israel, everyone according to his ways, says the Lord God. Repent, judgment is coming. Yes, we ought to announce the judgment of God. We must be faithful to everything the Lord has declared. It's appointed unto men once to die, and after this, the judgment. We're not going to hide the revelation of the word of God. Yet, immediately after that, let us show the love of God, and let us show them all is not lost. You can repent. Repent and turn yourselves from all your transgressions, so iniquity shall not be your ruin. Look at verse 31. In verse 31, cast away from you all your transgressions whereby ye have transgressed, and make you a new heart and a new spirit. For why will ye die, O house of Israel? In verse 32, it says, for I have no pleasure in the death of him that dieth, says the Lord God. Wherefore, turn yourselves and live ye, were courageously recovering transgressors from their trespasses. That's love. That's God's love in man. Look at number two. Number two is constantly rejoicing in the truth and truthfulness. We're told in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 6, rejoiceth not in iniquity. Somebody has not been acting right to you, among your neighbors, among the co-tenants, among the office workers in your place of work, and then that fellow fell into something degrading, and he fell into shame and reproach, and somebody told you, if you're a real Christian, you're born again, you have the grace of God in you, you will not rejoice in iniquity. Maybe they say the fellow has committed terrible sin and now they have dismissed him from that place of work. You're not saying, I knew that was to come. I knew that will happen to him because, you know, I've not enjoyed my position here as a worker because of him or because of her. You are rejoicing in the mishap, in the disaster that happened to that individual. Rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth. We're told in 2 John chapter 1, we're reading from verse 4. Here is the constant rejoicing that we have in truth and truthfulness. I rejoice greatly. Not just normally, I rejoice greatly that I found of thy children walking in the truth. When young people are saved, we rejoice. And when they are walking in the truth, we rejoice. Even if it's the children of other people, maybe you have a problem with your own child, that your own child is not getting up and is not getting on in the gospel. And you are laboring and you are suffering for that child, and you want him to be saved, you want her to be saved. It's difficult, it's hard, and yet you hear that somebody else's child got saved and is walking in the truth. You'll not say, well, am I going to rejoice? Look at my own child, how can I go out? If you're a real child of God, salvation is important. And salvation has happened to that person's child, and the angels of God are rejoicing. If you have the mind of Christ, although you still have your own problem with your own child, you will rejoice. I rejoice greatly that I found of thy children walking in the truth. As we have received a commandment from the Father. Look at verse 6. In verse 6, it tells us, it says, this is love, that we walk after his commandments. This is the commandment, that as ye have heard from the beginning, ye shall walk in it. In 3 John chapter 1, we're looking at verse 3. For I rejoice greatly when the brethren came and testified of the truth that is in thee, even as thou walkest in the truth. The truth is in you. You believe the truth, you embrace the truth, you declare the truth, and you're walking in that truth. Look at verse 4. In verse 4, it tells us, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. And then in Luke chapter 10, reading from verse 21. Luke chapter 10, verse 21, in that hour Jesus rejoiced in spirit, and said, I thank thee, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that thou hast hid these things from the wise and prudent, and hast revealed them unto babes. Even so, Father, for so it seemed good in thy sight. And then in verse 22, all things are delivered to me of my Father, and no man knoweth who the Son is but the Father, and who the Father is but the Son, and he to whom the Son will reveal him. The Lord rejoiced because the 70 came back and they discovered the triumph of truth. And when they declared the truth of the gospel, they said, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name. And Jesus said, I saw Satan, he fell like lightning from the sky, from heaven. And now he rejoiced that these ones have known the truth, and the truth is working in their lives. We're coming to number three there, and number three is confidently revealing the triumph of truth. Confidently revealing the triumph of truth. Look at Matthew chapter 22, reading from verse 16. Matthew chapter 22, we're reading from verse 16. And they sent out unto him their disciples, those are the Herodians, with the Herodians, saying, Master, we know that thou art true and teachest the way of God in truth. Neither carest thou for any man, for thou regardest not the persons of men. They knew Jesus Christ for that, that no matter who he was talking to, no matter who he was addressing, and no matter who he was preaching to, and no matter who he was ministering to, he knew that truth will triumph at last. And even if they were not accepting the truth, he will tell them the truth all the same. He will emphasize the truth all the same. He will drill into them the truth of the kingdom of God. And they recognized that, and they said, we know you that you don't have respect of persons. We know you that you are not partial. We know that you have the truth, you preach the truth, you live the truth, because you have the understanding and the consciousness of the triumph of truth. And therefore, they spoke it out, and it must be true about you, about me, and about us, that we do not try, okay, we're speaking the truth, and the truth is not having any effect on the people. Let's have psychology. Let's have some duplicity, and let's have some deception. No, you know the truth will triumph, and therefore you do not trade in error. You do not trade in falsehood. You do not trade in deception. You abide in that truth all the time. Truth will triumph. All around us, I said, truth will triumph. And let's look at John chapter 8, reading from verse 32. John chapter 8, verse 32, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. If there's anything in your life that shouldn't be there, if there's any deficiency, if there's any weakness, if there's any besetting sin, get near the truth. Read the truth again. Know the truth of Jesus Christ. And as that truth is implanted in you over and over, that truth will triumph over your weakness, over your deficiency, and over any evil around you in Jesus' name. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Look at verse 36. It says in verse 46, which of you convinceth me of sin? If I say the truth, why do ye not believe me? He told them the truth. They didn't believe. He kept on telling them the truth. Even though they didn't believe, he still kept on telling them the truth. Why? Because he knew on the final day, truth will triumph over error or falsehood. He tells us in John chapter 15, reading from verse 26, but when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth. The Holy Ghost is the Spirit of truth. Where there is error, the Holy Ghost will not stay there. Where there is deception, the Holy Ghost will not stay there. Where there is, telling lies, they say they have a goal for telling those lies, the Holy Ghost will not stay there. A preacher does not use lies to convince people that he should walk in the truth. God will not support deception or lie or falsehood to help your ministry and make people walk in the truth. The Holy Ghost will not help or aid anything you do out of deception, out of falsehood, and out of error. It says, if the Spirit of truth which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me. And then in verse 27 it says, and ye also shall bear witness. You have the Holy Ghost, and it's bearing witness out of you, and it's bearing witness to the truth, because the Spirit of truth, you also, because you are saved, because you are transformed, and because you are true, a true believer, and you are truthful, you also shall bear witness, because ye have been with me from the beginning. You never saw error or falsehood or lying or hypocrisy or deception in me. You have been with me from the beginning. And you know, I always tell the truth. I always show the people the truth. And you have been with me. You go and do the same. And if you do that and you abide in the truth, the works I do, you shall do, because I go unto the Father. Ephesians chapter 4, we're reading from verse 21. Ephesians chapter 4, reading from verse 21. If so be that ye have heard of him, and have been taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus. If you have known the Lord, if you are born again, if he lives in you, I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, but Christ liveth in me. And the things and the life which I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. It says, I stand at the door and knock. And if anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in. And he is the way, the truth, and the life. If you have then received Christ, and you have been taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus, then he tells us in verse 22, that he put off concerning the former conversation, the old man is deceptive, the old man is false, the old man is hypocritical, the old man goes in the path of error, the path of evil. You put up that old man, which is corrupt according to deceitful laws. And then in verse 23 it says, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Verse 24 it says, that she puts on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. What's the consequence of that? Verse 25, it says, wherefore, putting away lying, speak every man truth with his neighbor, for ye are members one of another. We'll come to point number three now. Point number three is gainful relationship through decisive love in all honesty. We're looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 13, reading from verse 7. Beareth all things, that's love. Believeth all things, that's God's love. Who bears all things, that's that divine love in the heart of a child of God, endureth all things. Beareth, continuous tense. Believeth, continuous tense. Who bears, continuous tense. Endureth all things, continuous tense. You see, the happenings in the world change some people. They were gentle, they were meek, they were loving, they were kind, and they were humble. But then some things happened to them. It came from that direction, came from that direction. And that changes some people, that they say, I cannot continue like this. You ought to continue like that. If the love of God is there, beareth all things, continues. Believeth all things, continues. They say, I cannot believe anybody anymore. I won't believe anyone anymore. You know why? I trusted that, I was disappointed. I believed that one, I was disappointed. And then I believed that one, and if you knew what happened to me, I'm not believing anybody anymore. God's love, divine love, demonstrable love, believers, all things, hopers, all things, you know. I hoped that person would change. A new year was coming and people are making resolutions. I thought he'll make a resolution and things will change. I hoped and hoped and hoped, nothing changed. I'm not going to hope anymore. I'm going to throw hope away. You know, if divine love is there, you don't give up on anyone. You don't give up on yourself. And you don't give up on the promises of God. Hopes all things, endures all things. You know, some people say, every man has his own limit. And I happen to have my own limit. And I've come to the end and to the edge of my limit. God knows I've tried. God knows I've endured. God knows what else will I do? And I'm being pushed and pushed and pushed. Now I'm pushed to the wall. No endurance anymore. But you know, the love of God in the heart of man, if we're saved and then we're sanctified, and that love is operating every time, whatever is happening in the family, whatever is happening in that place of work, whatever is happening with those neighbors, endures all things. I pray that this love will be deep-rooted in every heart, every life, even tonight once again, in Jesus' name. Gainful relationship through decisive love in all honesty. Three things we're looking at. Number one, patiently bearing all trials in love. Number two, permanently believing only the truth for life. And number three, pleasantly braving all things like our Lord. We're coming to number one. Number one, patiently bearing all trials in love. It says he beareth all things. Let us look at Romans chapter 15, reading from verse 1. We then that are strong ought to bear the infirmities of the weak. If you are truly strong, you're strong in faith, you're strong in the Lord, you're strong in the power of the Lord, you will not act like the weak. The weak is acting the way he's acting because it's weak. It's weak in faith. It's weak in character. It's deficient in his Christian upbringing. And if you are strong, you'll not say, okay, they're doing like that because they're weak. You're strong, you won't do it like them. Strong people don't act like weak people. Healthy people don't act like sick people. Educated people don't act like unenlightened people. If the grace of God has come to you, we then that are strong ought to bear the infirmities of the weak and not to please ourselves. It tells us in verse 2, it says in verse 2, let every one of us please his neighbor to his good, to edification. And then in verse 3 it says, for even Christ pleased not himself, but as it is written, the reproaches of them that reproach thee fell on me. And now in verse 4 it says, but whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the scriptures might have hope. In Hebrews chapter 13, we're reading from verse 13. It says, let us go forth therefore unto him without the camp, bearing his reproach. You see, the reproaches that come on us is because we're Christians. The persecution is because we're Christians. And the pressure on us is because of who we are. It's because we are for Christ. We stand for Christ. We speak for Christ. If you are not standing for Christ and speaking for Christ, those things will not come. Okay, if it's coming as a result of you representing Christ, let us go for therefore unto him without the camp, bearing his reproach. And then it says in verse 14, for here have we no continuing city, but we seek one to come. It tells us in 1 Peter chapter 4, and we're reading from verse 12. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12, beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened unto you. Then in verse 13, it says, but rejoice, it's inasmuch as ye are partakers of Christ's sufferings, that when his glory shall be revealed, ye shall be glad also with exceeding joy. And then in verse 14, it tells us, if will be reproached for the name of Christ, appear ye, for the Spirit of glory and of God resteth upon you. On their part is evil spoken of, but on your part is glorified. And then in verse 15 it tells us, let none of you suffer as a murderer, or as a thief, or as an evildoer, or as a busybody in other men's matters. In verse 16, but yet if any man suffer as a Christian, let him bearing all things, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God on this behalf. Look at number two here. Number two is permanently believing only the truth for life. When it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 7, believeth all things. Remember, Christ is our example, and Christ is our model, and Christ has left us that example that we should follow after his steps. He didn't believe the Pharisees. He knew they were liars when he said, we're children of God and we're children of Abraham. He said, no, that's not right. You're of your father, the devil, and the works of your father ye will do. Because he was a murderer from the beginning, and he's a liar. And whenever he does whatever he does, he speaks of his own, because he was a liar from the beginning. He didn't believe the Pharisees. He didn't believe the Sadducees, who said there were no angels. He said, you err, because you do not know the power of God and the scriptures. He didn't believe the people that came and they said, we know this is who you are, and you don't have the respect for any man, but you tell the truth. He said, why are you tempting me? And so when it says believeth all things, he believeth all things that are true. He has the spirit of discernment. He's enlightened in the word of God, and he knows that is the truth. And whether that truth is cutting across his opinion or whatever, he believes the truth of the word of God. I pray that we'll be like Jesus in everything, in Jesus' name. Look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, and we're reading from verse 13. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, reading from verse 13, for this cause also thank we God without ceasing, because when ye received the word of God which ye heard of us, ye received it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth. As it is in truth, the word of God which effectually worketh also in you that believe. What if there's error? Are you going to believe the error? 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, we're reading from verse 10. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 10. And with all deceivableness of righteousness in them that perish, because they received not the love for the truth, that they might be saved. There are those who are not saved. There are those who are backsliding. And because they are not saved, because they are backsliding, they do not have the love for the truth, and they do not tell the truth, and they can be smiling and telling you a lie, and you will not believe that because you are saved, you are a child of God. You only believe the truth. Look at verse 11. In verse 11, and for this cause God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie. If somebody believes a lie, he will act on that lie. If somebody acts on a lie, he will form. If somebody acts on a lie, he will be in the hands of Satan. Satan came to the garden and said, don't you eat all this? And Eve said, we eat everything except one of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Why don't you do that? Because the Lord said, in the day that you eat that thing, you will surely die. And Satan said, there's nothing like that. You'll not surely die. And if you eat it, your eyes will be open. And Satan told him a lie, sold her a lie, and she accepted the lie. And it says Satan is still doing that until today. And for this cause, God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie. If somebody believes a lie, what happens? Look at verse 12. In verse 12, that they all might be damned who believed not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. I pray you will not fall for a lie in Jesus' name. 1 John chapter 4, we're reading from verse 1. 1 John chapter 4, we're reading from verse 1. Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone into the world. Look at verse 3 there. In verse 3, it tells us, and every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. But this is that spirit of the Antichrist, whereof ye have heard that it shall come, and even now already is it in the world. The spirit of the Antichrist already in the world. Therefore, you'll try the spirit, and it's only when they tell you the truth that matches with the scriptures, that you will believe. Look at verse 6. In verse 6, it tells us, we have God, and he that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth not us. Look at this. Hereby we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. There's a spirit of error. You'll not believe that when it says charity believeth all things. There are all things that go in line with the truth. Look at number 3 here. Number 3, pleasantly braving all things like our Lord. It says he believeth all things, he beareth all things, he hopeth all things, he endureth all things, he endureth all things. There's nothing that will come to you that you cannot endure, and there you still remain and abide in the spirit of God, in the spirit of Christ, and you remain in the love of God. It tells us in Hebrews chapter 12, reading from verse 2, it says, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Is the one that gave us the faith, is the origin of the faith, and is the one that made us to have the faith to be saved and the faith to be sanctified. And it says, we're all the time looking unto him, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross. He looked beyond the cross, he saw the crown. He looked beyond the cross and saw the commendation of the Father. And because he was looking beyond the cross, that's why he despised the shame. And now he sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. It says in verse 3, it says, for consider him who endured such contradiction of sinners against himself. Anytime you have trial, anytime there's misunderstanding, anytime there is persecution, anytime there's pressure, anytime something contrary is happening, consider him who endured all contradiction of sinners against himself, lest he be weary and faint in your mind. If you're looking unto Jesus, you will not be weary. If you're looking unto Jesus, you will not faint. If you're looking unto Jesus, you'll not be tired. If you're looking unto Jesus, you'll not say, I cannot go further anymore. You'll go further. You'll go higher. And you'll progress in the Christian life in Jesus' name. And you resist everything that will get you back to sin. Look at verse 4. It says, ye have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin. Love does not mean we'll accommodate everything. We accept everything. Even when they lead us to backslide, to false doctrine, we say, we have love, we have love. No, love is the love of God that will not accept sin, that will not embrace sin, that will fight against sin. It says, ye have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin. And I pray the grace of God will abide in every one of us in Jesus' name. The grace of God will abide in you. And you'll be able to do everything as the Lord expects in Jesus' name. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, I'm reading from verse 4. In 1 Corinthians chapter 13, and we're reading here from verse 4, charity suffereth long and is kind. Think about yourself. Charity envieth not. Charity vaunteth not itself. Charity is not puffed up. In verse 5, it says, it does not behave itself unseemly. Seeketh not her own. Is not easily provoked. Thinketh no evil. And in verse 6, it says, it rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth. And then in verse 7, it beareth all things, and charity believeth all things that are true, who bears all things because he knows God is on the throne, and endureth all things. If you do these things by the grace of God, you'll never fail in Jesus' name. And you'll never fall in Jesus' name. We're going to stand up now and we come before the throne of God. And we're asking for grace. Who is sufficient for these things? But the grace of God can be abundant in our lives. And the grace of God can help us so that our heart is cleansed. Our heart is purged. Our heart is purified. Our heart is sanctified. And the old Adamic nature that's always getting irritated and furious, and fretting and getting angry and having this and that, the Lord will take all that away, and then this life of love the Lord will produce in your life, in my life, in the life of everyone in Jesus' name. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord in prayer. You need grace, more grace. You need the blood of Jesus to wash you once again, as white as snow, whiter than snow. You need this love of God to be deep-rooted in your heart. You need something more than natural love, human love, society love, literature love. We need the love of God planted in the heart, being justified by faith, we have peace with God, and the Spirit of God sheds abroad His love in our hearts. And the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering. Open the door of your heart more unto the Lord. Let your spirit move in gently and the gentleness of the Spirit will be in your life. The love of the Spirit will be in your heart. The meekness of Christ, the Spirit of God will reproduce in your life. Temperance, self-control, the love of God will restrain your tongue from speaking words of anger, words of strife, words of jealousy and envy, words of pride. The Spirit of God will birth in you the love of God. And he'll give you the grace to crucify the flesh and the lusts thereof. Bring back to mind some individuals near you, around you, at home, in the office. You say they are difficult to live with. They are difficult to work with. They irritate you. They annoy you. But remember, God can give you the love that is not easily provoked. And the love that thinketh no evil. Tell the Lord he can do it. Ask him faith, nothing wavering. He knows you need this love. And he knows that without this love, this charity, all is vain. All activity, all ability, all gifts, all achievement, everything is vain. Without this love, ask him, shall be given unto you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, it shall be opened unto you. Everyone that asketh receiveth. If you ask him for love that makes you meek, everyone that asketh, receiveth. Ask him for love that makes you gentle to other people. Everyone that asketh, receiveth. If you ask genuinely, and you want to walk more gently, you want to walk more humbly, you want to walk more loving, you want to walk in lowliness, you want to walk in loveliness. And if you discover in your life seeking preeminence, always wanting to be above others, always wanting to show off preeminence, if you see that nature in you, that's the nature in every man, it's common. Every woman, it's common. But if you present it to the Lord and say, Lord, I don't want to be puffed up. Charity vaunteth not itself. It's not puffed up. It does not seek preeminence. Does not seek excessive recognition. He lives a lowly life, a gentle life, a life that is hidden in the grace of God. Tell the Lord, everyone that asketh receiveth, he that seeketh findeth, to him that knocketh the door of grace, and the door of overflowing love, that door will be opened. And remember, faith without works is dead. As you pray and you believe the Lord has done it, you'll think of someone that you have been having difficulty relating with. That anytime it says A, then you say B. You cannot restrain yourself. Now that you pray and you believe that the grace of God is now more abundant in your life, watch for the next time that person is there. That you say, by the grace of God, I'll manifest gentleness. I'll manifest lowliness. I'll manifest loveliness. I'll manifest the character of Christ. I'll bear reproach. I'll believe the truth. I will hope for the best. I will endure what I couldn't endure before. Tell the Lord, He's able. There'll be peace in your family. Where this love is, husband and wife will not separate. Separation means you don't hope for the better. And you are not willing to endure all things, fighting, strive, being glory, comes there because you are not bearing all things, believing all things, hoping all things, enduring all things. Our God is able. He wants to reproduce Christ in you. He has that perfect Son of God, loving Son of God, gentle, meek, and lowly. And He has brought you into the kingdom so that the life of Christ, the gentleness of Christ, the lowliness of Christ, the meekness of Christ will be reproduced in you. And He'll make you a man of peace. He'll make you a woman of peace. And anywhere you are, the peace of God will reign. In Jesus' name we pray. Father, we thank You tonight for the revelation of Your word. You've spoken to every heart. And the natural man will not be able to do this. But we know, when Your supernatural love comes into our hearts, things will change. Therefore, Lord, we pray You touch all Your children, brothers and sisters, young and old, and reproduce the life and the love of Christ in every one of us in Jesus' name. We pray, Lord, the nature of Satan will not prevail in us. Amen. But to replace the nature of Satan and the nature of the carnal man and the nature of our own family of bringing, remove that nature from us in Jesus' name. Amen. Plant Your love deep-rooted in every heart. That now our relationships, our restraints, our response, everything will be guided by Your love. And we pray that this love will not just be a one-night love, one-day love. It will be the love of God in our hearts all through the rest of our lives in Jesus' name. And that attitude of hearing and forgetting, remove that away from us. We will not be forgetful learners, but this word will bear fruit in every life in Jesus' name. Show Your love more again to everyone, and reflect more of Your love from our hearts to everyone around us, Lord. Confirm it in every life. And let every life be profitable and progressive, even from now on, in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray.
Amen.